Deutschlandfunk Kultur. Sein und Streit.
Ein Gespenst geht um in Europa, das Gespenst namens Slavoj Žižek. In den vergangenen Jahrzehnten ist er auf hunderten Konferenzen, Podien und Bühnen aufgetreten. Die Liste der Bücher, die er, der slowenische Philosoph, geschrieben hat, umfasst bei Wikipedia nicht weniger als 46 Titel in englischer Sprache. Bekannt geworden ist Slavoj Žižek mit dem Versuch, Untote wie Sigmund Freud oder Alfred Hitchcock oder auch Wladimir Iljitsch Lenin zum Leben wiederzuerwecken, zumindest im Geiste. Wir sprechen in dieser Stunde mit ihm über Karl Marx, dessen 200. Geburtstag am kommenden Samstag begangen wird. Genauer, wir sprechen mit ihm über das Kommunistische Manifest, also über jenen kurzen Text von Marx und Engels, der vor genau 170 Jahren erschien, der rund 150 Jahre lang eine der größten Hitsingles der politischen Philosophie gewesen ist, den man heute wohl als Oldie bezeichnen muss. Slavoj Žižek kann ihm aber etwas Neues abgewinnen, jenem Text, der mit dieser Fanfare beginnt. Ein Gespenst geht um in Europa, das Gespenst des Kommunismus. Žižek ist ein psychoanalytisch denkender politischer Philosoph. Was meint er zu Marx und dem Kommunistischen Manifest? Wir haben das Gespräch vor der Sendung aufgezeichnet. Slavoj Žižek, zugeschaltet aus Ljubljana in Slowenien. Freue mich sehr, herzlich willkommen.
Das freut mich auch, vielen Dank.
Sie haben ungezählte Bücher geschrieben und auch ein aktuelles. Gleichzeitig ist bei uns in Deutschland im Fischer Verlag ein kurzer Kommentar von Ihnen erschienen über das Kommunistische Manifest. Sie haben das Manifest wiedergelesen, erstmals veröffentlicht 1848. Bevor wir in den Texten genauer schauen, würde ich gerne mit Ihnen gemeinsam ein bisschen in die Welt schauen, weil Ihr kurzer Kommentar, da tauchen ja auch viele Beobachtungen auf über unsere Welt heute. Ich nehme mal eins raus, das ich am frappierendsten finde, Ihr Blick auf sowas wie Sklaverei heute. Also für Sie ist völlig klar, dass es auch heute, 2018, noch Sklaverei gibt, beispielsweise Immigranten auf der arabischen Halbinsel oder in asiatischen Sweatshops, aber eben auch in Europa. Und eine ganz beiläufige These von Ihnen, die taucht fast als These gar nicht auf, sondern in Ihren Augen sind solche Sklavereiverhältnisse ganz normal, denn sie gehören strukturell notwendig zum Kapitalismus, wie er heute ist. Inwiefern ist das so?
First, I would like to say how from the very beginning Sklaverei was part of capitalism. Let's not forget that in late Middle Ages in Europe, slavery was slowly disappearing. Then, with colonialism, it got a big boost again. And I think something similar is happening today. This new slavery has different forums. You already mentioned these sweatshops in third world country, half legal immigrants in our Western even countries, who live in conditions of half slavery. But let's not forget the clearest case, the Middle East countries. If you look into this famous thriving economically Emirates, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, and also other countries there, immigrant workers definitely have, not legally, but de facto, status of slaves there. The lesson from here is, for me, is the following one, that you cannot say in the old Fukuyama way that this is just a marginal phenomenon which gradually, in with slow progress, it will disappear. No, it is emerging again and again, because, and that's my thesis, although, as Marx wrote, universally, capitalism needs human freedom, but capitalism today cannot any longer endure in the conditions which are its own formal conditions. I, as a free worker, have a contract with capitalist. In order to survive, it must break its own rules. It needs slavery on the edges, and so on and so on. So let me avoid a misunderstanding here. I'm not some kind of a fanatic who is blaming capitalism for all evil things. We should never forget that the way we criticized slavery, the way we advocate democratic rights and so on, is the very conceptual apparatus which makes us see slavery as something absolutely unacceptable, is something which emerged through capitalism. So capitalist modernity, and that's great about it, brought the very apparatus which enables us to criticize it. So I'm not a kind of fanatic anti-capitalist and so on. What worries me is just that I see today, I'm not very original here, signs of general regression in the very simple sense worldwide, that things which were unimaginable to advocate them publicly, open racism, even open, more or less open, anti-Semitism, and so on, or the use of torture. 20 years ago you did it discreetly. Now we have a debate about it. How things which are unimaginable 20 years ago, 30, now we can talk about them publicly. And I believe in appearances. I think appearances, good manners are essential. And that's what is happening today.
Eine Rückfrage hätte ich auf der Ebene des Phänomens Sklaverei. Wo beobachten Sie sowas in Europa? Denn es kann ja nicht in Ihrem Blick zutreffen, dass man zeitgenössische Sklaverei tatsächlich einfach nur in Asien oder Arabien beobachtet, sondern ich fürchte auch im Herzen Europas in Ihren Augen.
In Europe, of course, it's more marginal, but I think I mentioned in some of my books, do you remember about a year or two ago, there was a fire in Forort, in Amarant of Firenze. And we learned that some 40, 50 Chinese workers lived there in absolute conditions of slavery. And then they discovered that in that small city, there were 14, 15,000 Chinese workers who did it, who lived in these terrible conditions. So even in our cities, the status of those not so much refugees, purely illegal immigrants, but we have these half-legal immigrants with unclear status. So what's important to see here is that it's not simply we, Europe, are innocent, it happens out there. Even when it happens there in faraway countries, we are also responsible. The big example for me is Congo, the absolute catastrophe today. A big state which isn't operative as a state. You have local warlords who exert extreme terror, but they all sell rough stuff, metals and so on to big companies. So Congo is a metaphor for our world. For me, it's outside the rule of law, slavery, terror, drugged children, perfect soldiers, but as such, it's perfectly integrated into global capitalism.
Ich würde Ihren Blick ganz gerne kurz auf gewissermaßen das andere Spektrum der Gesellschaft lenken. Ebenfalls inspiriert aus Ihrem Buch, ziemlich gegen Anfang tauchen da Figuren auf wie Bill Gates von Microsoft, Mark Zuckerberg von Facebook, Jeff Bezos von Amazon. Also ein bestimmter Unternehmertyp, Konzernchefs von heutzutage, die gehören zu den reichsten Männern der Welt. Sie sind Gründerfiguren und exorbitant erfolgreiche Figuren aus der digital geprägten Welt. Und nicht zuletzt verkörpern sie ja auch alle so einen Typus des neuen oder zeitgenössischen Philanthropen. Also die wollen alle was Gutes, Menschenfreundliches für die Gesellschaft tun mit Stiftungen, mit regelmäßigen, gigantischen Spenden. Wenn Sie diese drei, vier Herren beobachten, wofür stehen die? Sowas gab es, diesen Unternehmertyp gab es noch nicht zur Zeit Mitte des 19. Jahrhunderts, als Karl Marx geschrieben hat.
Yeah, now you pointed out where one key point where we should move further from Marx. Okay, I can explain this in more, I don't want to lose too much time, more theoretical terms. What are we getting today, and all these figures verkörpern, embody this, is what I call the privatization of commons themselves. Each of these figures is not selling a particular stuff. Like Bill Gates with Microsoft and so on is selling us our commons, the very apparatus that we use to communicate with each other. Amazon is almost monopolizing the book market and DVDs and some other and so on and so on. So these are figures who are no longer the old private capitalists. They are in some paradoxical sense owner of our common space. And something like this Marx was not able to see. But these figures, nonetheless, I'm not just critical towards them. You know where they fascinate me? First, their philanthropy, I'm skeptical about that. I used in one of my old books this vulgar metaphor, I got it, I ate it once, of chocolate laxative. Chocolate gives you constipation, but in the United States you can buy a chocolate which at the same time works as a laxative. They're for me chocolate laxative capitalists. First they exploit you brutally and then at the same time they bring you with their humanitarianism, help. They try to undo in the afternoon what they do in the morning. And just to conclude, what I find nonetheless fascinating with these big names is that they themselves all doubt capitalism. The latest fashion among them is to say capitalism, at least the way we know it, no longer really works to solve, I don't know, problems of unemployment, of ecological catastrophes and so on. We need some new collective self organization. Even they know it that capitalism is in a crisis. And the really sad thing is that to counter this with some leftist proposal appears inefficient today. I don't see, now that we really need it, an alternative to global capitalism. I don't see any consistent proposals from the left how to do it. It's very sad that now, while left is more and more focused on defending the alt-rights, trade unions and so on, it's the capitalists themselves who see much clearer the forthcoming end of capitalism.
Ich hätte eine Verständnisfrage zu Ihrem Ausdruck Privatisierung von Gemeingut, die Privatization of our commons. Ist es nicht eher so, dass diese genannten Herren, ich nehme einfach jetzt mal Mark Zuckerberg von Facebook raus, soziale Medien, das prominenteste, größte der Welt, dass es sich da eher um die Privatisierung des Privaten handelt, also eine eigentlich paradoxe Kurzschlussgeste. Meine Daten sind privat, ich gebe sie Herrn Zuckerberg und dann sind sie neu privatisiert. Das ist doch eigentlich nichts Gemeingutartiges, sondern was Privates, was da privatisiert wird, oder?
You made a very nice point. I agree with you. I forgot to mention him, maybe the best example, Mark Zuckerberg. And I was furious at him. He gave a speech at some university half a year ago, where he said people today should get out of their small private concerns and get a sense of a common good, of higher causes. This said a guy who, through Facebook, contributed probably most in the entire world that we are using time with pointless private conversations and so on and so on. I mean, in my, sorry for this totalitarian outburst, in my universe, if I would be Weltherr of a new world order, Zuckerberg would be the first to get a one-way ticket to Gulag. Okay, but that's another point. What I want to say is that, you know, in what sense I talk about Privatisierung des Allgemeinen. Yes, I agree with you. Facebook is the medium where we exchange our private dreams and so on and so on. But nonetheless, what I'm talking about is that the space is a global space. The space, like the Facebook network in which these exchanges are done. And I think it's crucial not to privatize this public space in which we exchange our points. And what really worries me, it became clear now through Cambridge Analytica scandals and so on, is that it's not just privatization. It's at the same time privatization deeply connected with NSA state apparatuses and so on and so on. What worries me is how these agents of like Google, Facebook, agents of privatized public space, closely collaborate with state security agencies, which is why, incidentally, we don't have time to go into this, but it's an important point, I'm skeptical of the very expression neoliberalism. Here, Marx was maybe too close to liberals. Marx still thought that we have some fundamental domain of economy where capital reproduces itself and state just externally regulates us. No, states are not disappearing so that just big concerns rule. States play more and more important role as direct agents in economy itself. This is, I think, the mystery of the success of states like Singapore, China, and so on. This new combination of wild capitalism, very efficient, with extremely strong authoritarian even state. This is our future. And I think that's the tragedy of the success of people like Donald Trump. He's moving America into this direction. That's why I still think, in an old-fashioned way, that the idea of Europe has some importance today. The new world that is coming to be now is the world of these strong half-authoritarian leaders, with usually America first, Russia first, India first, China first, strong national orientation. When there was tension 2 years ago or three between Russia and Turkey, I proposed a term Putogan, like the Verdichtung of Putin and Erdogan, as the new figure. And I think these Putogan figures, Trump passed into it, Xi, the new Chinese leader, and so on, this is the future. And I think, in a very old-fashioned way, that only this emancipatory European legacy can save us from this new, more authoritarian phase of capitalism.
Die erste Veröffentlichung des Kommunistischen Manifests war 1848. Lassen Sie uns kurz mal ein bisschen näher an den Text rücken, den Sie da kommentiert haben, den Sie wiedergelesen haben, der Sie vermutlich viele, viele Jahrzehnte begleitet hat. Und als guter Dialektiker gibt es in Ihrem Kommentar natürlich viele Passagen, die darauf hinweisen, wie sehr nicht aktuell das Kommunistische Manifest heute ist. Nur einer von vielen möglichen Punkten ist die Frage nach dem revolutionären Subjekt. Also in dem Manifest ist natürlich das Proletariat, die Arbeiterklasse, adressiert als revolutionäres Subjekt. Und Sie machen klar, dass eigentlich über all die Jahrzehnte und Jahrhunderte des Marxismus hindurch in Ihren Augen es ein echtes revolutionäres Subjekt nicht gegeben hat. Richtig?
Ja, richtig. Let me repeat myself from my introduction to Manifest. I'm very proud of the beginning, where I quote an old, I like old Soviet communist jokes, yes, where the Radio Erevan, which gives always the same typified answer. In principle, yes, but the question is it true that the Jew Rabinovich won a new car on the state lottery? And the radio answers, in principle, yes, but he didn't win a car, it was stolen from him, and it was not new, it was old, and so on and so on. So this is how Kommunistische Manifest works today. In principle, it's still true, but the conditions have changed so much. For example, what you mentioned, the paradox today is that what Marx designated as a worker, you have a permanent job in a big company, okay, you are exploited, but you have, at least in developed capitalism, social security, free education, and so on and so on. To be this perfect, exploited, but permanently employed working class member is almost a privilege today. I would say that hundreds of thousands of immigrants coming to Europe, they don't come here to make a revolution. They come here to become this perfect working class people. And those who are in a position of proletarians for Marx, not in the sense of working class, but in the sense of those underprivileged who have nothing to lose, we have to look for them elsewhere. It's like maybe precarious workers are in that position, permanently unemployed, and so on and so on. So something doesn't work today if we immediately apply Marx's vision from communist manifesto. Now, Mao Zedong tried to save this problem by simply moving to international arena. He said, today we have capitalist states, bourgeois states, and proletarian states. The West is all capitalist, but this is a terribly wrong simplification. If precisely if we want to remain faithful to Marx, we should move further from Marx. We should see the radical changes.
Darf ich das vielleicht einfach auf Deutsch nochmal kurz zitieren mittendrin, weil es ist so schön und es ist so berühmt. Die fortwährende Umwälzung der Produktionen, die ununterbrochene Erschütterung aller gesellschaftlichen Zustände, die ewige Unsicherheit und Bewegung zeichnet die Bourgeoisie-Epoche vor allen anderen aus. Und jetzt alles Ständische und Stehende verdampft, alles Heilige wird entweiht und die Menschen sind endlich gezwungen, ihre Lebensstellung, ihre gegenseitigen Beziehungen mit nüchternen Augen anzusehen. Zitat Ende. Das ist so tatsächlich so eine Art von Refrain oder Hit oder so aus dem Kommunistischen Manifest von Marx Engels. Und ich finde, schreiben Sie auch, dass das doch eigentlich zunächst mal klingt wie eine Beschreibung unserer Gegenwart, also wie maximale Moderne, alles Ständische und Stehende verdampft.
But it went much further than in Marx. Marx still was not aware how far this can go. For example, I think these passages from Kommunistisches Manifest give us a key to today's Me Too, gender, transgender movement problems, and so on and so on. Even what Marx still would have perceived as our basic identities, which are somehow fixed by nature, sexual orientation, sexual identity, and so on and so on. All this ist heute inbegriffen, ist caught in this capitalist dynamic. And this is something new that maybe changes deeply Marxist analysis, because where do we stand with regard to these new movements, transgender and so on, where our basic personal identity, even what appeared once biological, becomes plastic, which can be changed, and so on and so on. This brought me trouble with some feminist and transgender people, because I insist that if we apply here strictly Marx, then these movements are not necessarily anti-capitalist. They just actualized at the most radical point the innermost tendency of capitalism. So it doesn't surprise me that the big bad guys that we already mentioned, Bill Gates, Zuckerberg, they were all passionately for transgender people and so on and so on. This is the innermost tendency of capital. It's not automatically something revolutionary. So what makes me nervous is when I hear these transgender people posing as if they're doing something extremely subversive, undermining capitalism. No, they're playing the capitalist game to the end.
Diese Kritik an sowas wie identitätspolitischen Kämpfen, die Sie jetzt gerade nochmal formuliert haben, am Beispiel Transgender, erlauben Sie die Rückfrage, ist das nicht, wenn Sie Ihre Gegnerschaft da so markieren, ist das nicht eigentlich der falsche Gegner? Sind die so wichtig? Müssten Sie sich nicht eigentlich konzentrieren auf größere Gegner, Mark Zuckerberg und so?
I deeply agree with you. My problem is just this one. It's not me who concentrates himself on this. It's today's, at least in the developed countries like United States and so on, it's the so-called cultural left who is doing this. I remember I was in the United States 3-4 months before last presidential elections. The cover story in New York Times, in Canadian journals, was what to do with transgender problem of toilets. Should we make unisex toilets, 3 toilets, male, female, and the third one for them, and so on. I mean, this was the main topic. No wonder that then Trump won. I think the big problem that we encounter here is how all this identity, politics, sexual politics, and so on stuff became predominant in this way. Left become more and more cultural left, losing the support, we all know this, I'm not saying anything original, in its own working class. That's why I think that people like although they have their own limitations, but people like Bernie Sanders, Jeremiah Corbyn are very important. As somebody intelligently observed, the secret of Bernie Sanders' success is that he mobilized for the left people, disappointed ordinary working class people who would have otherwise voted for Trump. So I think the big problem is this cultural left who took refuge in this extreme form of politically correct moralism. The problem with them is not that they are too radical, too crazy. No, they are not radical enough. Their extreme moralism is a way to avoid crucial economical and political issues. Let me give you, to conclude, an example, very simple one, which for me is perfect. Steve Bannon, who was fired by Trump. Yes, he is a racist, almost neo-fascist, and so on. But you know that Steve Bannon, and that's why he was fired, really, by Trump, thrown out of the White House. He opposed Trump's tax, new tax law. He said, no, on the opposite, we should raise taxes for the rich people up to 45-50%. We need big public works and so on and so on. You see, this is a perfect example of how only this almost neo-fascist right dares today to make proposals which were traditionally the proposals of social democracy and so on. Something is deeply wrong here.
Ich versuche ganz kurz mal besser zu verstehen, was Sie eigentlich für ein Verhältnis zu Marx haben in all den Jahrzehnten, in denen Sie intellektuell und auch politisch ja aktiv gewesen sind. Sie sind nominell Philosoph, Sie sind auch Psychoanalytiker. Jedenfalls sind für Sie natürlich die Texte von Freud zentral. Soweit ich das weiß, haben Sie die vermittelt bekommen, vor allem über Jacques Lacan und dessen Schule. Ja. Der in den 50er, 60er, 70er Jahren so eine französische und wie man damals sagte, strukturale Rückkehr zu Freud versucht hat. Inwiefern ist denn da überhaupt Platz für Marx-Lektüre gewesen? Sagt man so gut, in den 60er Jahren war das alles immer verknüpft, Freud und Marx. Und gleichzeitig gab es ja auch eine Rückkehr zu Marx über einen anderen französischen Philosophen, Louis Althusser. Aber mich würde interessieren, wie würden Sie Ihr Verhältnis zu Marx charakterisieren? Ist das wichtiger als Freud, weniger wichtig als Freud? Ist das politischer?
Hier habe ich eine klare Antwort. Wir können darüber schreiten, Marx oder Freud, aber wie es klar ausgeht aus meinen Schriften, es gibt eine dritte Figur, die wirklich die wichtigste ist. Hegel. Ja. Ich bin für einen Rückkehr zu Hegel. Ich sprach auch manchmal über materialistische Umkehrung von Marx selbst zurück zu Hegel. Mhm. Hegel war, und das klingt wahnsinnig, das weiß ich, mehr Materialist als Marx. Have to go to English. With Marx, we still have this basic trust into the future, a certain evolutionary progressism, even if it's not automatic, determinist, but the present situation opens up hope for a communist future and so on and so on. Hegel was much more open and pessimist, if you want. Look, you know, when Hegel says in Vorrede, to Rechtsphilosophie, Hegel says there that the old of Minerva, wisdom, philosophy, comes only in the evening and can only explain conceptually a social situation, an order, which is already disappearing. We cannot predict future. Situation is much more radically open for Hegel. Marx was here too determinist, I claim. We have to get rid of this last remainder of evolutionary determinism in Marx. And also second thing, I give you a radical provocation here, which raises the hair of many orthodox Marxists. You know, perhaps the best known phrase of Marx is that the 11th these, philosophers have only interpreted the world, we must also change it. But isn't it that the lesson of the 20th century is maybe the opposite one? We tried to change the world too fast, without knowing what we are doing, and we ended up with Stalinism and so on, so that maybe our 11. These today should rather be, we should not just try to change the world. We should step back and interpret it better. So just a short, very short remark, which I think is funny. Once I had a debate with Fukuyama, and I told him, okay, maybe you won, in the sense that global capitalism is winning, but isn't it, and he laughed at it, he admitted, the ultimate irony that those, in most cases, not Cuba and North Korea, but others, were like China, China, Vietnam, where communists are still in power, they are today the best managers of efficient capitalism. Isn't this a supreme irony of history that would have escaped Marx?
Sie beziehen sich auf Marx' 11. Feuerbach-These. Philosophen haben die Welt nur unterschiedlich interpretiert. Es kommt aber darauf an, sie zu verändern. Zitat Ende, ungefähr zitiert. Und Ihr Witz ist jetzt, Sie drehen es um, ne? Also wir haben die Welt eigentlich zu stark geändert, alles Stehende und Ständische verdampft. Und wir müssen eigentlich einen Schritt zurücktreten, um sie ein bisschen besser zu verstehen. Richtig kapiert?
Ja.
Ja, ich finde es interessant, ich finde es sympathisch, ich finde es
aber
plausibel.
Aber, gehen Sie zu aber.
Ja, ja. Ja, genau.
Ich sehe schon, wie Sie hinter in Ihren Rücken schon den Messer, you are sharpening the knife. So.
Genau, absolut. Nein, ich wollte Sie einfach nur erinnern an Ihre große leninistische Phase ums Jahr 2000 herum, als Sie zusammen mit dem französischen Philosophen Alain Badiou an vielen Stellen erklärt haben, Freud hat da gar keine große Rolle gespielt, Marx hat keine große Rolle gespielt, Hegel auch nur für philosophische Feinschmecker. Der Name, der Autor, den Sie propagiert haben, ein paar Jahre lang war Lenin. Warum eigentlich? Und ist der für Sie heute auch noch wichtig?
Ja, aber in a very modest way. What I admire about Lenin, and I also published in the fall it will appear in German, a selection of Lenin's texts from the last years of his life. What I always admired about Lenin, although I'm not trying to save Lenin, the result of his works were horrible things. There is no Stalin without Lenin, and so on. But first, Lenin was never afraid to see the total failure and then to draw, sometimes even in a very opportunistic way, to draw consequences. Lenin was, in this sense, in a good sense, radically pragmatic. But you know what really fascinates me in Lenin? In the last years of his life, when he saw what turn things are taking towards horror, he became obsessed with two things which sound very politically incorrect today. Above all, Western culture and civilization. He said in 21-22, it's stupid to talk about socialism today. All we can do, Bolsheviks in power, is try to bring something of Western civilization and culture, West European, to Russia. And surprisingly, his accent on kindness, good manners. Remember his famous testament where he proposes to Politburo to fire Stalin. His criticism of Stalin does not concern political question, like Stalin's politics is wrong, etc. It's all about Stalin's manners. He said, Stalin is too brutal, too rough, and so on, and so on. This is the Lenin that we should learn from. This, what I call in my book, Courage of Hopelessness. Situation is hopeless, blew it up. It didn't go as we planned with the revolution, but nonetheless, we are here, we must gather the courage to go on. That's the Lenin I like. And I'm well aware of all the horrors that Lenin is co-responsible, but this, very strange, that is not usually associated with Lenin, this spirit of modest improvisation and of minimal civilized kindness, good manners, and so on and so on. Today, precisely, when it's not the leftists, but the right-wingers, alt-right, who are becoming more and more brutal, talking in an openly racist way and so on, we need manners. The left, it's a crazy idea, I know, should become the party of ordinary people, moral majority, with good manners and so on and so on.
Sie haben gelegentlich über Lenin auch gesagt, man müsse einfach die leninistische Geste wiederholen, was immer das dann genau sei. Und über Marx schreiben Sie in diesem Marx-Kommentar oder Kommentar zum Kommunistischen Manifest, Es geht nicht darum, dieses kommunistische Manifest jetzt 1:1 heute zu lesen, denn es ist ja eben, die Rahmenbedingungen haben sich enorm geändert, sondern es geht darum, eine marxistische Geste zu wiederholen, Anlass zu wiederholen. Also Marx nur in diesem Sinne treu zu sein. Und außerdem gibt es in der Conclusio bei Ihnen den Blick, dass Kommunismus natürlich heute keine Lösung sein kann, sondern die Bezeichnung eines Problems. Und zwar das Problem der Commons, des Gemeinguts, wovon wir vorhin schon mal kurz gesprochen haben. Gemeinguts der Natur, Biogenetik, Erbgut, aber auch kulturellen Gemeinguts. Das ist für Sie das, was da so drinsteckt in dem Wort Kommunismus. Mich würde jetzt mal etwas Konkreteres interessieren. Also Sie haben ja auch mal eine Zeit lang als Politiker gearbeitet, um 1989. Gibt es denn so Ideen, von denen Sie glauben, wie man diese marxistische oder die sich auf Marx berufende Geste wiederholen kann? Welchen Sinn man sowas wie Kommunismus als Problem geben kann, konkret?
No, I will be here quite open. No, I always say that the task of philosophers today is not to bring solutions, but to stellen richtigen Fragen, to raise the right questions. And I think that the questions that we are proposing today, as you already hinted at, are precisely the question of commons, Gemeingüter, and so on. Ecology is the question of our natural substance. Even, I would emphasize this, all this artificial intelligence and digital manipulations of our brain, these are, or biogenetics, these are also questions of commons, who will regulate our natural substance. Then even in capitalism itself, in narrower sense, the problem today is intellectual Privateigentum, private property. It's obvious that capitalism will not be able to integrate so-called intellectual property into it. So I think that our problems are the problems of commons, and if you think I'm just utopian here, let me evoke a witness which will shock not maybe you, but many in Germany. I found some very similar thoughts in, Peter Sloterdijk, where he writes about the need to civilize civilizations themselves, about the need to break this self-reproduction of capital, which is basically indifferent towards its natural conditions, Bedingungen, and so on and so on. For me, in so far as I designate myself as communist, and I told him this, he laughed, to Sloterdijk at a round table 2 weeks ago in Amsterdam, I consider him a colleague in this communist struggle. The problem are the commons. So again, I'm not a magician, I don't pull the rabbit out of the hat. I just try to present to you the right hat. It's up to you to pull out the rabbit.
Okay. Meinerseits vielleicht nur noch eine letzte Frage, nämlich die, ob Marx und das kommunistische Manifest nicht dann doch für einen Blick wie den Ihren auch ein bisschen was Folkloristisches oder Nostalgisches hat. Der Beginn des kommunistischen Manifests, der ist auch so eine kleine Hitsingle, der geht so: Ein Gespenst geht um in Europa, das Gespenst des Kommunismus. In mindestens einem Ihrer vielen Bücher geht es ganz ähnlich los. Ein Gespenst geht um in Europa oder in der akademischen Welt, das Gespenst des Subjekts, wenn ich mich recht erinnere, in Ihrem Buch Die Tücke des Subjekts. Für mich klingt das einfach so ein bisschen, als könnte man Marx auch ausbeuten, wie eine Band einen anderen Song covert und dann was sehr Eigenes draus macht.
Absolutely, but this is how theory progresses. Now I will shock you. I don't believe in dialogue in theory. I will say now something more philosophical, but I hope provocative enough. If you look at the ways philosophers were reading other great philosophers, they usually either misunderstood them or brutally appropriated them, or usually both at the same time. There is no philosophical dialogue. Aristotle misunderstood Plato. Stoics misunderstood Aristotle. Kant misunderstood Spinoza and others. Hegel misunderstood Kant. Marx misunderstood Hegel. And we can go to the end. So I think there is this type of brutal exploitation that is, and that's why I like philosophy, that is the reality of philosophy. Let me conclude in a provocative way. Yes, we have to have dialogue. But my favorite dialogues are the late Plato's dialogues. You know, how do they look? One guy, Socrates, talks all the time, and the other guy, partner in the dialogue, interrupts him every 10 minutes with something like, yes, by Zeus, so is this Socrates, du hat recht, and so on and so on. Let's face it, philosophy works like that. You could be a one-sided fanatic, not considerate towards others, and so on and so on. And here I am kind of a philosophical Stalinist. Yes, the greatest service Marx can do us is to allow himself to be brutally exploited, manipulated by us today. In the same way that he manipulated Hegel and others.
Philosophie als Feier des Missverständnisses. Slavoj Žižek liest Marx. Tausend Dank.
Und noch 1001 Dank an Ihnen. Danke.
Mehr von Sein und Streit hören Sie auch in unserer App. Der DLF Audiothek. Jetzt kostenfrei herunterladen für Android und iOS.